you're listening to OSWTV on, well, YouTube, I think, somewhere, or I don't know where I'm going to put this, but you're listening, we're going to do a podcast on Hell for Lycra 11. We might do about other stuff, I don't know, we're going to see where we go. You're listening to Billy Strachan, I am, of course, the voice of OSW and one sexy son of a gun, and we're also joined by Kevin Morrison.
How are we doing?
He is a fan of Scottish professional wrestling, starting from Hell for Lycra 9, that was our first event, and has been to the last two Hell for Lycras, a couple of W3L shows as well. Introduce yourself.
How are you doing, guys? I'm Kevin, as Boy said. This man's idea to get into Scottish wrestling, we first debuted, so to speak, at Hell for Lycra 9 a couple of years ago, and Saturday just passed was our third Hell for Lycra in a row. And SWE is just setting the Scottish scene on fire at the moment.
So I have done a lot of attending wrestling shows in the last, this is the third year. So it must be, I think, my 25th show now in general, just
easily.
Every company in the world. Every company in Scotland. So we went down to Aberdeen. God, went through Aberdeen. Went to Dundee for Hell for Lycra in the most easiest run I've ever had in my life. Because I've always got lost doing these runs. So we got there, it was nice and straightforward.
Unlike Hell for Lycra 9. But that was then, and that was Perth, so it doesn't matter.
So oh, that was horrible. I had to drive back the same night. I got back at 1 o'clock in the morning, yeah. Dead.
We learned the hard way.
Oh, the second year was fine, because I didn't have to drive, because I broke my arm. But yeah, so we got there, we were in the queue and all that jazz. We eventually got filed in, and we were told it was £20 for, you get a photo with Animal, you'd have the spikes on, he'd have me in face paint, and it would be all good. So we got there.
And framed. That was the key part for me.
Oh yeah, unframed, yeah. Although I thought the frames were going to be like frames, not like the cardboard ones we got.
School pictures, but, well, yeah. Not complaining.
Wasn't even personalised. we got there and we were in the queue. I was spending most of my time just like shaking hands. It was weird. It's like, oh, hiya.
You're a famous man.
I know. It's still weird.
Even I got around and said, oh, you're that guy, aren't you? I was like, yeah, I'm Billy's friend. Hi. Like, you comment all the time. Yeah, that's me. Cause I'm Billy's friend. That's
But so we got there, we met Animal, and I can honestly say, he is by far the grumpiest person I have ever met in professional wrestling.
Rumours about other ex or current WWFs or E guys from whatever era they're from, and never heard anything about Animal, but yeah.
I mean, X-Pac was lovely, and Animal was just right grumpy git.
I got three grunts. I was like, hey Animal, how you doing? Shoot with hand. And I was like, oh, I really love your stuff. You're going, loved your stuff back in the 80s. Yeah. I was like, put spikes on. I was like, oh, thank you very much, Arnold. Thank you. Yeah.
I got even, like, well, I got more than that, but less. Because I had Hasbro figures with me, and I thought I would show Animal them. I thought it'd be quite cool. If it was anyone else, probably went, oh, that's quite cool. But all I got was, oh, there's nowhere to sign them. Cheers, Animal. That's. No, I was showing you a hawk and Animal. I would have liked you to at least. I would have taken patronising. Oh my god, they're cool. I would have taken that. I would have been okay with it. But no, I got nowhere to sign them. So, anyway, Dennis Stamp's nice.
Yeah.
I only went up to like shake his hand and say hello. And I ended up like hearing about him writing books and all that stuff. Oh, he's so cool.
For that 5 minutes that you were there for. I mean, even though I only caught half the conversation because I had my turn with Animal, I mean, I could listen to him all day because the guy just, knowledge, just boom, boom, boom.
He's the guy that's only remembered for not being booked for Terry Funk's, one of his many retirement matches and beyond the mat, but God, I could have spoken to him forever. He was so calm, he was so,
he was just open. Animal was such a closed book, his posture and is the way he was. Dennis Stamp was sitting, he was laid back, he was relaxed, he was like, oh, hey, how you doing? It's like, oh, yeah, you're cool. Animal. Yeah. Alright, Animal, go, hi.
He's literally an animal.
Yeah, he was.
Animal. So, we ended up, then we went and got food and stuff. Oh, no, we spoke to Alan.
That's what we did. Spoke to the world famous and my personal SWE hero who I mark out for all the time and get hammered at FIFA.
Yep.
Mr. Alan, Alan Smith, Mr. News there.
So I don't want to give too much away because it's going to be used on our radio show. But you should tune in to Monster FM in the month of September. And you'll hear the interview that I did with Alan about Discovery Wrestling. But this is about SWE, so I better not speak about Discovery just yet.
Later.
We'll do that later. But yeah, so that was all good, all fine. Then we queued up for the show after we got food and stuff.
After about a half hour wait, show kicked off. Well, we walked in obviously first, straight away. Cage, better looking cage than Hell for like a Nine.
Oh.
Happy days.
It was Hell up on its own. That was a big improvement from Hell for like a Nine. And then showed Grado versus Colt Cabana from Hellbound on the big screen
while they were all
set up.
Something else, because it was a comedy match with all the comedy spots, but it just worked, and I was absolutely creased myself, and I was like quite upset that I didn't go to Hellbound because I considered it, but not to worry.
That was always next year. But so that was booked well in advance before the whole Iron Jew thing happening in ICW. So that was like the rubber match, and I cannot remember who won off the top of my head. I think it was Colt. But
yeah, it looked like Colt won.
I think it was, I can't remember the end of it, because it was like, I might have got chili. Because there was chili pots as well, so I got chili. But so then the event kicked off. They showed the big highlight package of Chaz Phoenix versus Steven Magners. This is going to be amazing. This is going to be sadistic. I wasn't expecting blood. I was expecting violence. And had
two guys
hammer.
That have been there, done it all, and this is it. One of them is walking out finished. The other is walking out with a future. The other has no future. That is it. Done.
Yeah.
We're not talking Ric Flair here. I'm retired. 2 years later, TNA, I'm wrestling again. No, this is it. End story.
Yeah. So this is going to be like a really personal... It's been built up since like December, January time.
Oh, easily.
When Magners returned. And then, of course, Magners and Hughes beat the Syndicate after Williams walked out. So that was January. And it just didn't... It didn't work. It started off well, throwing each other in the cage and that, and the big high impact moves and the big superplex, which probably broke the ring. All that was great. And then it just ended.
Yeah.
The ending itself was good. It was a good end, but it needed a build up to it.
The ending made a lot of sense, but without the storytelling and the build up to get to the point where Phoenix jumped over the top of the cage and actually physically hung Magners by the sort of white belt strapping that held the cage together.
Oh, that's what it was. I never even noticed what it was. I thought it was like punching or something like that.
Yeah, it was like white belts, like strapping that held the cage together in various parts.
Okay.
But it made a lot of sense because, yeah, that was
right. It represented the plastic bag when you tried to actually kill Magners.
Yeah.
I was there and I was scary to watch.
Seeing it on the big screen, I was just like, that's insane.
Oh, his face is purple.
Yeah, no wonder.
You don't gimmick a plastic bag,
unfortunately.
But yeah, it just started well. There was a good high impact middle, and then it just finished.
Yeah, it sort of fell flat. I mean, don't get me wrong, I love the ending, but for me, there could have been a bit more sort of storytelling and getting building up to, you know, like how desperate Magners was to keep his career and how desperate Phoenix was. Also, the desperation came across because yet again, Phoenix basically tried, in no way to describe as kill Magners.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about it.
So, I don't know. It was an interesting way to start off. It was kind of like starting on a downer. But in fairness, it went down. It went shooting back up the next match. But before that, they took down the cage and they showed Martin Stallion versus Demo from the last ever Ardler Complex Uprising.
I've already seen that match on YouTube a couple of times, but my God, I could watch that match all day long.
Yeah, I was in and out watching it because I was doing other stuff on Facebook and whatnot.
How'd you do?
As I do, but it was great. Stallion. Every time I've seen that balcony when I go to Uprising shows, I've wanted to see someone jump off it, and
it happened.
It happened basically. Yeah, Stallion jumping off. And then he built some good momentum onwards to this to Hell for Lycra. Everything looked like it was Stallion that was going to win. But we'll speak about that a bit more later.
The way that match demo went at the last Uprising was just the start out, it seemed that Dable was going to absolutely destroy him because this whole sort of strength came in. But as the match went, Stallion came into his own more and more.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like you previously mentioned, that high spot off the balcony. Oh, something else. Just something else.
Stallion's pretty much the uncrowned champion, basically, of SWE. Yes. I think you can easily say. He's one of their own guys. And we'll speak about Stallion when we get to the main event. But the next match was the World of Sport Legends match. Now, I only found out that it was going to be Team Marty Jones versus Team Saint the day before, but I did have a wee bit of research. It wasn't announced on the SWE Facebook page, but I noticed that Mikey and the guys from Reckless Attempt did say it was going to be Team Marty Jones versus Team Johnny Saint.
Yeah.
So it was Marty Jones who had the Jackal and Rollins defeating Team Johnny Saint, which is Mikey and Felix Fortune. All the guys put in a good shift. Felix is still so inexperienced, but he had a good amount of veterans around him.
And he did look good, despite the veterans maybe to a little bit. I wouldn't maybe go as far as actually carrying him, but more sort of like guiding him through things because of his experience. But he did look good, and he's definitely one to watch for the future. I certainly enjoyed the match.
I still think, as I put in my review on OSWtv, it needs either to tone up or wear a singlet because for a bigger body, the Jackal's more rounder, but you can tell he's toned.
Mm-hmm.
That's just his body shape. He's just he's just round.
Yeah.
But he doesn't suit Fortune at all. He just needs to cover it until it's all toned up and a bit harder, because it's not the greatest to see his belly jiggling around as he's doing spots. I don't like that. I mean, my belly jiggles around when I do stuff, so I know how it feels. But Felix was obviously the one that was taken into the corner and just battered by the Jackal and Rollins. Rollins is the first time him and Mikey was the first time I've ever seen them, because they're Reckless Attempt guys. I haven't had the chance to see them in SWE, even though Mikey has had a couple matches there.
Definitely.
But I would definitely see them again.
Oh, Rollins is fantastic. The guy he pulled off so much good things. Mm. And it's like, you're thinking, what's he going to do here? And then just out of nowhere, just something, boom, I was like, that's fantastic.
Yeah, Rollins, he was more the unknown entity for me especially, and for probably the crowd as well. Because, as I said, Mikey was at Hellbound, so this is the first time Rollins was really there.
Yeah.
The Jackal was just heel.
Jay was just fantastic again. I mean, we seen Jay last year at Hellflicker 10. He won the number one contender's future division match, and then eventually cashed it in after Stallion turned face after an attack by the Syndicate, if memory serves me right.
You're right.
And basically the past year, whenever the Jackal's appeared on the SW Facebook, I've been straight onto him, just giving it out as much as I can to him. And he's been giving it back. He's just a great heel. I actually met him after the event on Saturday. And he asked me who I was. I told him, he's like, I know you. You're that guy who gives out to me because you're a great heel and I absolutely love it. Just keep giving me back until you own me, because that's what I live for.
Yeah, I mean, that's the best thing about about the Jackal. He's just an asshole. As soon as I realised, I said I wasn't going to swear, but he's just an asshole. As soon as he comes out, he's smug. Yeah. You're an asshole. You see him pose, thinking he's like God's gift.
Yeah.
He's an asshole. That is all I can say. And
keep the God references for later on.
Nah. But yeah, everything Jackal does is just, there's nothing likable about him.
And that is what you want from a heel, because he can work the crowd. As soon as he came out, like you said, he was there, he posed, he was smug, he's on the apron, people are booing the hell at him. He's like, you all shut your faces and sit the hell down. And of course, straight away, the crowd like that, boo. I'm not doing what you say. So it's like they're getting even more in his face, and he's straight up to the guys in front of us, he's like right in their faces, and it's just like, yeah, that's exactly what I live for.
Yeah, that is a heel. I mean, you see some heels do like flashy spots still. He doesn't have to do any of that.
No.
He can be grounded, he can just basically beat on the opponent, go as slow as possible, and everyone hates it, which is... But it's not like it's like ignored, like, mm-hmm. Oh, this is boring. It's, God, do something! Yeah. Why isn't he doing anything? Boo! Yeah. But, exactly. Fantastic. And then I moved on to probably one of the best matches of the night, which was the 8-man.
Oh, that, wow. I mean, I've seen the Trident across videos and numerous postings by Braveheart and other wrestlers and seen what the Trident have done. But my God, they were good.
MDK is something else. He is a big dude.
He's a big, big boy, but he, you wouldn't think, the way he moves in that ring on Saturday night, you wouldn't think he's a big boy. He's like, I'm trying to think who's like a really good comparison. He's so big and he moves so well for a big guy.
Oh, I could probably compare him to, give him a bit of time. Damo.
Yes.
That's probably my guy I could probably recommend, like compare him to, because he's a big dude, but he's got a good bit of speed in him, and...
Aye, without a doubt.
I just wonder if he can talk. That's the only thing. If he can talk as well, jeez.
He's not even been there for a year yet, so there's plenty of time.
Yeah.
Plenty of time for that.
I would say Darren Blair is probably he would be the talker out of them. Because Air Miles, like, he's got such a it's quite a sick face he's got. It's like, it's totally calm.
Yeah.
He's beating the crap out of everyone.
Yeah.
And he's just totally calm.
It's great. It's like the sick.
It's quite scary to watch.
It's a psychopath element that you need in a guy who can potentially tween. He can be heel or he can be face, because he could be psycho, but he could be beating the crap out of like a bad guy, and that would be absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, but he just does it with no emotion.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, you can look at some guys and go, oh, he's not doing anything. He's not doing facials, but it's just the fact that he doesn't change.
No, there wasn't even a glimmer of emotion. I mean, you can certainly liken him a little bit to Dean Ambrose. You look at Dean Ambrose before the Shield splat in the WWE, and whenever he was doing anything, there was never an emotion. It was just clear, concise, barking orders at their guys, mm-hmm. and then beating the holy hell out of anyone that came near him. And then he turned face, and his little feud were all in his off film, filming his movie. No emotion, but absolutely just beating the crap out of the guys. I mean, yeah. the backstage promo, like, just the other week on Raw there, where he nailed Rollins the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge, was like, what? It's for charity. And then, out of nowhere, started beating the hell out of him. I could see Stephen Miles doing that with relative ease, because he can just do it.
It's just no emotion, but it's just terrified to look at.
Yeah.
And then I have Scott the Butcher Rennick as well, who's always a very good hand in the ring.
Yeah.
Scott the Butcher loves puns.
Does he?
I would just throw that out there. He loves a good pun.
If I'd known this and I'll have the chance to meet him on Saturday, then I probably could have come up with some terrible puns and we could have had quite a good laugh. But there'll be other events, yeah. It's fine. But continuing on this match, I mean, we've missed out the other team. There's Newsy, there's Claymore's, LJT, Scotty Riccio, who's came back from the healthcare. I mean, those guys, they all had a minimum of one really great spot each, where it wasn't all suicide dives, because one was a vault press over the top rope.
Yes. Scott Riccio was a Sai moonsault.
Yeah.
But it was great to watch, though. It was like all of them did high spots, but yeah. None of them were the same. Claymore went for a suicide dive first.
Yeah.
News went for his vault press, which he probably has a name for it. I wanted to think of a news pun for it, but I can't.
Yeah.
Breaking news. No, yeah. That's terrible. The LJT just flew.
LGT was that, yeah, he was fantastic. I mean, he came back in later on, but we'll go into that later on, but LGT was brilliant. But, I mean, the way the match ended, the 450 splash, I was just like, that's a 450 splash! Oh my god! It was like, you know, athlete marking out, and that's, you know, a lot of people don't get that a lot from these things, but that's just the sort of, the way I am with wrestling. It's like, I love it so much, it's like I can find almost anything I can find to mark out over.
Right.
And that's what the fourth I marked out already. It wasn't even in. I was like, oh my god.
Oh, Riccio was dead.
Yeah. poor Scott Riccio got absolutely destroyed. Do like two finishers, like one of which was an F5, the other was like a 450 splash, and then he do like a giant splash as well. It was almost like, in fact, it was okay. Was that the world's strongest slam?
Yeah, it looks like a world's strongest slam. Yeah. I don't know if there's a name for it, but it was definitely a world's strongest slam anyway. And
definitely. And,
got killed.
Poor guy.
Poor Sky. Although he did have cool gear, which I said was like a dragon.
Yeah.
I got shouted at for saying it was a dragon. but yeah, it was good to see him back, and I think we're going to have a good run. Hopefully, he can. I reckon he could probably have a good couple of matches with Christopher Saint over the future division title. Easily.
There's so much potential for the future division title. I mean, you can liken that to the X Division TNA, but despite being, well, obviously I'm biased because I hate TNA, but the future division is a fantastic division. I mean, the guys and girls, because there's always Sammy and Viper that have been, and Nikki Sorg was also in the future division match, you know, which leads us nicely No.
No, it doesn't.
Almost leaves Thursday. Sorry, I'm getting the card wrong there, but we'll go back to Future Vision.
Before that, though, we've got Joe Hendry,
global hero,
defeated Doug Williams.
Which billion miles for?
Oh, Joe Hendry. Beforehand, he came to the venue in a suit. Just
Billy marked out.
There is a class, and then he shook my hand.
Billy marked out. And to quote the Simpsons after I believe it was the girl's name was Laura in the Simpsons, spat on Bart's hand. I'm never washing this hand again. That was he didn't say those words, but my God, the moment was there. I'm never washing this hand again.
It was the look of intent on my hand. It was like. Well, I'm doing this on audio. It's like that. I'm just watching my hand going, ah!
Anyway. Walking back to the Bonner, Billy's like, I shook Joe Henry's hand.
He shook my hand. I just reciprocated. I
was only giving out on Billy because I only seen Joe Hendry once. I was like, yeah, he seems alright. But I mean, obviously, a workhorse like Doug Williams brought out the best in him, and I was like really, really, really impressed. I'm really looking forward
for
to
a lot of Joe's
him.
Matches in SWE. A, worked heel, which isn't in this match, and B, he was more of a powerhouse because he'd be working with like some of the smaller guys, so he was more of a powerhouse.
So it worked out that way.
But this one, it was wrestling. It was just pure wrestling.
Nothing but wrestling. That
very
match,
little non wrestling.
There's no big high spots or silly catches, things like that. You can do with bigger guys. I mean, they're both big guys, give them a due, obviously. But yeah, this was
just wrestling.
Pure. If you wanted, apart from the main event. If you want something that's absolute pure ground-based technical,
main event's not ground-based.
No, maybe not ground-based, but you know, if you want something that's absolutely pure, brilliant wrestling, you know, for which you know, a lot of that you do find in these independent companies, and SW's got a hell of a lot of stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, certainly in terms of talent, sheer work rate, for me in terms of work rate, this was just marginally second.
Yeah, it was very crisp. There was very little. I can't remember anything off the top of my head that was inherently sloppy. There was a couple of bits missed, but they just went back to it, and it was fine. There was nothing.
The only thing I noticed was like a slightly sloppy arm drag, but that didn't even bother me because the impact was there, and it looked good enough to get away with it. It's just because I've got a keener eye, haven't been a fan for so many years.
But they did do the same spot three times, which was going to the Chaos Theory.
Yeah.
Countered. Arm drag, but the third time I did it, went to the arm breaker, cross arm breaker, and Henry won. He's a big dude, so you can pull off an arm breaker because he's just a big guy, so you can pull it. But yeah, they did the same spot three times. You think after the second time, Doug would have learned not to turn around, but that's just being really picky. If you're taking it literal as it's real life, you would have thought the second time he wouldn't have. Yeah. After the second time, we've done it the third time, but that would just be me being so picky. But I enjoyed it. It was a good match.
That's a fantastic match.
So next up, it was good and bad this match because I enjoyed them. It's the Future Division scramble match that was actually a flag match.
Yeah, that's for me. That's probably the main talking point. I mean, no offense to any of the guys in SWE, and I'm not turning this podcast into anything political at all. But it was a yes Scotland flag. All I'm going to say in the matter is, I'm a no voter, and this is not my personal opinion, it's my professional opinion, but they shouldn't have had a yes flag. And that's all I'm going to say in the matter. I don't want this to turn political. I don't want anyone, when you see it on Facebook, etc., saying, oh, well, you said this and that, because that's it. This is not about the referendum, this is about SW's health for like Halloween.
Yeah.
And I think, in my opinion, that flag shouldn't have been used, but hey, I'm not in charge, that's what you want to go with, so you know, I'm going to roll it.
I think they could have done it just as well with the Scotland flag.
Yeah, they could have done it just as well with the saltire, or even a made-up flag, you know, like a Future Division flag or something like that.
So with SWE written on it.
Yeah.
I don't think a heated topic like the referendum should be brought into it. A, with no story. There's no story around it. It's not like, why are they going for this yes flag?
I mean, if there'd been a bit of build-up, you know, like, oh, because... Again,
there was no way it could have worked. There was no way it shouldn't be used, basically.
Knowing that the SWE are backing a yes vote, that's fine. They've got the reasons, I've got my reasons, but you know, if they'd maybe brought it into a storyline, you know, could have like, I don't know, maybe the champion, Christopher Saint, coming out and be like, staunch no voter because of his actions. Obviously, his actions after showed
What he's doing. So, something that would have made sense. Maybe even a small promo package or something like that. Just something just to put it over a little bit. But, no. I mean, the action itself was good, but much like the ladder match last year, it was too chaotic. As in...
Yeah, it was too much going on, and it's hard to watch. It doesn't matter what promotion you're in. Or, you know, it could be WWE, and it could be a Money in the Bank ladder match or whatever. But when you've got that many guys and girls, in this case, in the ring, it is difficult to try and watch where the action is. I mean, Nikki Storm was classic heel. Like, oh yeah, keep beating him while sneaking along the apron.
No.
And very almost getting the flag at the very start of the match. And then every other chance to get the flag. You know, Viper had her chance, and then the low blow, which was just ridiculous, because obviously Viper being female, and there to low blow. Sammy had her chance, Saint had a couple of chances. LJT, Dunbar.
LJT probably was the closest out of... Yeah. Well, because he was just about to get it before getting battered.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we just mentioned LJT. Yeah, he's pulled double duty.
Yeah, but, right, I forgot about that, yeah.
I don't know why. Because there's no reason.
Well, there's no reason, but...
I'm not complaining about it. LJT.
LJT's great. I mean, the setup was there, though, for something in the future, you know. Quite possibly, LJT's signed. I mean, the way the match finished with LJT being... Not really screwed, but being taken out of, like... contention by Simon just at the very end when he had his hand in the flag.
Yeah, so I think it's definitely building towards LJT and Saint. Dunbar, not enough good things I can say about Dunbar, because he's just arrogant. He's so arrogant in the ring. But he had a good spine buster.
And Viper.
D'Lo Brown's finisher is sky high kind of thing, because he sat down as well. So it's like sit down spine buster.
Yeah.
That's probably right.
That's what it was to me. And
Sammy had a great Enziguri in there. She is just... That's the third time you've seen her.
Yep, third time I've seen Sammy, third time I've seen Nikki Storm, second time I've seen Viper. Viper, for me, she didn't get as much offense because the sort of style of match. Last year she fought Bette Noir, and again, as Viper knows, if you're listening to Viper and Bette Noir, if you hear this as well, as I tweeted them numerous times, I've said... To me, they saved me for women's wrestling because I despised it and was like, nah, women's wrestling's terrible all over the place. But nah, that too had a great match last year. It wasn't great to not get so many spots, but she still had a good outing, in my opinion.
But for Sammy, though, that's the third time you've seen Sammy. The first time you saw her, she was like less than a year into her career. And
she was green.
Green is goose. she was with Nikki Storm. And the second year saw her, she was in the six-man match, so you didn't get to see a lot of her, but
was still good last year. A much, much bigger improvement last year than on Health Lycra 9 2 years ago. And then this year, like I said, the Enziguri, I was just like, Sammy's there now. I'm just like, totally, Sammy's brilliant.
Yeah, Sammy, if anyone has a chance to watch her on YouTube, do it, because she has so many good matches with the likes of Debbie, Nikki, and Viper as well as... her match on Fierce Females with Kaylee Ray.
I've not seen that yet. I need to get into seeing that.
Yeah, you should watch Mad Max scene as well. It's on YouTube. I'm gonna get a hold of it at some point and review it, but
fantastic.
It looks great. Right. Next up. Our pal, Animal.
Close personal friend.
I have a lot to say. I don't want to rant because I think that would be silly. But Damo came out for his match with Animal. They played the highlight package. They played the package coming up to this, and it's going to be big. It's going to be a huge match.
Absolutely buzzing for Damo after what him and Stallion done last month. Plus, seeing Damo live the first time at Half-Like 10, I was like, I love Damo. This is going to be amazing.
Yeah, he came out, and it was great. And then we spotted the Trident coming through the fan entrance.
And as you do whenever a steel comes out, holla holla player, we got a tag team match, players.
But yeah, they came out, surrounded the ring, and basically beat up Damo with a chair, Renick brought in a chair. Only for Animal. I mean, this beating lasted longer than it really should have.
Yeah,
I mean,
came too late for me. I mean, it was coming, but it was just like...
Yeah, it was like, well, alright, Animal, you've taken your time there. So Animal came out, not in gear, so obviously he wasn't planning to wrestle tonight.
No.
Do you think he was a member of the Trident or something? He'd sent the Trident to beat up Damo because he's too scared to face Damo or something like that?
Quite possibly. I mean, we met Damo last year, and he's the nicest guy on earth, and both gave us like a shot at the championship for the photo, but it's just like, you're a big guy. I'm would never be the ending.
So I mean, that's what I'm thinking now. Is I mean, I'm hoping it leads on to something else. But yeah. Do you think Arno may have sent the trident?
It's quite possible. I mean, certainly.
The only way that would make me really look past the fact that he wasn't even in ring gear. If he's supposed to have a match, why was he in ring gear?
Yeah.
John the Bomb Graham came out, which I marked out for, because I didn't actually think I would see him. I would see John the Bomb. And then there was the laziest Doomsday device.
Oh, dear. Yeah.
Well, Animal, I'm assuming if he has an injury at all, it'll be his arms or his shoulder or something, because he didn't even pick him. He picked him up in like a heart attack kind of move, like the bear hug that Jim Neidhart did.
Yeah.
And then John the Bomb just...
destroyed.
Just missed. Well, just hit him.
Yeah. Destroyed himself.
Destroyed himself with a heart attack. And it just... we'll have to see how it leads on, because it has to. If it doesn't lead on and that's it, then that was awful. That's pretty much all I can say. If it doesn't lead to anything, then it was a waste of time. What was the point again, Animal? He was mean.
Yeah, but I think that reading into it, I think there'll be something more. I mean, you look last year at the whole Bret Hart came over, and although Bret Hart was only there for like one sort of like event, you know, there was lots of build up into it, and like we knew Bret Hart was coming, and then the announcement was made that X, Y, and Z was happening. I was like, oh wow, this is actually really big. It's not just he's here for this. So maybe they're doing the opposite with Animal. Maybe they're like, Animal's here for health for like 11. He's fighting demo. That's it. Then there was that issue with the Trident and Animal.
It's like, oh, we have to bring Animal back.
Yeah.
To sort it out.
Yep, it's quite possible.
So I hope so, because otherwise, for a match that they built up so much.
Yeah.
Left a sour taste in my mouth a little bit about that. Next up was probably one of the loudest matches, I would say.
Yes.
UNG Mackie against Braveheart. For a guy that hasn't wrestled in about 16 months, Braveheart didn't miss a beat.
Not one beat at all. I spoke to him after the match, and I said, you know, shook his hand again. I was like, I thought you were done in the ring. He's like, there's always time for a comeback. I was like, I know, but like, legitimately,
hear about his head injuries and all that kind of stuff.
You know, because I've seen your stuff. I went back to your Facebook and that, cause to catch up on other stuff and seeing what you've done. I genuinely thought that for health reasons that you had it. But I was quite glad to see you back, because you're a nice enough guy, because you speak this whole time.
Right.
Plus, you're accomplished in the ring, obviously.
Yeah, and
you're not like your typical sort of Vincent McMahon character, you know. To an extent, there is a Vincent McMahon-esque aura about Braveheart.
Oh yeah, the evil owner.
Yeah, which is fine, because it works. And at some point, every promotion's got to have that, because it works so well. But I mean, Braveheart was he was great. You would have thought his last match was last week.
Yeah, this is loud, by far the loudest. I mean, for the main event, it was loud for different reasons, but this is just full of. Because Braveheart basically attacked Ewan at the start.
Yeah.
We'll get to the incident about before the match at the end, because we'll both probably have very strong opinions about what happened. But yeah, the match itself, Braveheart was on offense for a lot of it.
Yeah.
Before my favorite referee, Edith Summer, or as everyone chanted, Esther. She's not called Esther. She's Edith.
is that not a real name?
Kayfabe. Edith. Her name's Edith on the website. It's Edith. Although I think her surname's a slight at someone. I just realised that. Her surname might be a slight on some very over-enthusiastic fan that may or not got chucked out.
Ah.
I get it now. So there was a sharpshooter, and Ewan was tapping.
Yeah.
Edith ignored it, and she was hilarious. For someone who only first in-ring stuff was the PA thing, which was like April, she's very good. She's very good facially. She's really good character.
Yeah, you wouldn't think she's only been there for, well, April's what, 4, this is August, so it's essentially 4 months, maybe I push 5 months if we say it was the start of April, so for someone who's been there for a maximum of 5 months doing it, you know. And obviously
being over with the crowd as well.
Yeah, and obviously maybe not doing very little sort of like crowd interaction. stuff aside from the assistant contest and potentially, well, but, not potentially, but they're already showing off to Braveheart, you know.
She gets it. Basically, yeah. she's a good character and obviously a lovely person, but she's very very good when she's in the ring, and she just played it brilliantly. So she ducked a punch by Braveheart.
Ducked two punches by Braveheart.
Just ducked second. Second one, right at the end, in the corner. But I ducked one, and Ewan sprayed mist into Braveheart's face, and that was good for the win, pretty much.
Yeah.
So.
It was a classic face fast count 1, 2, 3 like that.
And it was all good. And it just definitely has to, it's going to lead to something more, and it's going to be good. Because
I don't know, because I mean, like.
Well, I think it'll lead to something more because Braveheart's going to have to get Edith back.
Yes.
Overall, she'll get the upper hand and it'll be all good. But he can't ignore it.
No.
From that way, it has to continue and play out and finish.
Yeah.
So I think this might just be the start of Braveheart and Ewan, possibly. Because he was giving Jammer a looking afterwards, so maybe we'll see Z-List come back together again. And I don't know. It's good lot of potential. Yeah.
And speaking of Ewan, I mean, that's the fifth time I've seen Ewan, and brilliant. Ewan.
His character.
Oh. I've met Ewan now, and that's probably the fourth time you've met him, if not more.
A few times.
Yeah, but he's such a great guy. Like, straight away, before even I or even you get your chance to put your hand out, he straight away his hand out. So, how you doing? Yeah. Did you enjoy my match? It's like, I've seen you a handful of times now, Ewan, and just you're fantastic.
But you see him, because he looks odd.
It makes the character.
Well, it makes the character, but people, casuals, fans who haven't seen him before, automatically write him off.
Yeah.
Because they see the tutu and
the bright highlighter green leopard print.
The skullet as well, his hairstyle.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's in the ring. And he's just
so
brilliant.
Accomplished. And he's so good.
It's just brilliant. So, we're on to the main event.
Well, before we go there, speaking of Ewan, there was a slight, slight incident, so that way. As far as there's two actual incidents in this match.
Yeah, as far as we do it after the main event. So, because we'd have to speak about the second incident at the same time.
Well, we'll move on then.
Aye, so we'll speak about the incident at the end. Because I really don't want to give her as much press and coverage, but it has to be said, and it will be said in a moment.
Yeah.
Right, so we've got the main event. So it was hashtag scumbag Ian Ambrose, and he defeated the number one contender, Martin Stallion.
In our opinion, is the uncrowned SWE heavyweight champion.
Yeah, pretty much. So they showed the package beforehand, the promo package, just showing how good Ambrose is, and Stallion being great in the ring.
Yeah.
Probably a little bit of tweaks regarding to his promo style, but other than that, I really can't complain when he's that good in the ring. It started off quite slowly. These guys, I've seen them wrestle numerous times. Last time was the DDP show, and it ended up in the crowd. So, lo and behold, this match ended up in the crowd.
Yeah.
Dennis Stamp was the special guest referee, probably the most lenient referee I've ever seen.
in terms of a referee not actually having a side to be on,
it was straight down the middle, but
in terms of a straight down the middle ref, as opposed to a referee that's like going to the heel of the face, you know, you straight down the middle, and
he let it run,
and it worked so well. Because, I mean, for the build-up to these matches, like, Ambrose, he's pulled out a couple of wins out of nowhere, and a couple of dirty wins as well, you know, like, using the rope, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Which makes perfect sense, because he's an absolutely brilliant heel character. It's like, I had a few interactions with him on Twitter beforehand, and it's just like, he's telling me, like, I've been told by many other heels, don't cheer for me, I don't need you. And I'm just like, coming back, hashtag, I'm a scumbag too, and he's like, no, you're not. It's like, I am, trust me. It's like, I love your work, and he's like, nah.
No, he's just one of those guys that, he's very eccentric and his promos, and it's great. You don't know what you're going to get with him, because he has so many finishers as well, as he always says.
And that's the best part, because a surprise package like that, you don't know what you're getting. He's going to create something brilliant.
Yeah. So he came out in a white lab coat with blood on it. I'm doing air quotes.
Yeah.
Blood on the back of it saying, I am God. So there you go, there's heel heat for you if you need it.
Exactly. Straight away, I am God, no matter what you think of anyone else, I am God. And it's like, well, that's fair enough. That's going to get the heat. You go for it.
Yeah, so he had black latex glove and surgical mask.
And he got booed out of the building.
Oh, he did. And
it was fantastic.
But when you actually got into the match, though, it was very split, I found. Anyway, yeah. There was quite a lot of cheers for both of them. I think I was more testament of the work they put in, that it was very much a split crowd.
Without a doubt. I mean, as much as I love Stallion and I love Ambrose, it was hard for me to sort of embrace my usual I love the heel, I hate the face, because I cannot slag Stallion off.
Yeah,
there's nothing annoying about him I can slag off. His work rate, his ability, his moveset, what he does in the ring, the way he conducts himself out of the ring during matches, you know, it's just, oh, brilliant. Same with Ambrose. I mean, you know, like a lot of people will be like, oh, he's a bad guy, X, Y, and Z, but he's brilliant. He is so good at what he does. Like, you know, the I am God quote, perfect, prove it out, you came, tell, screaming at everybody, sit down, shut the hell up. Fantastic. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. So eventually went into the crowd, and I think you pointed out there was a mother in a pram that was getting far too close.
Yeah, she was. I don't know if it was bad timing on her part or maybe their part from the spot they went to, but of course it's a bit hard to try and remember your spots in the match and go through it and take it to where it's got to go in terms of storytelling. But I mean, this last scene, Stallion and Ambrose coming out of the ring. Seen Ambrose mount and get over the barrier and still continue to try and get forward despite Ambrose clearly coming in our direction.
Yeah, it's. I mean, if it's just yourself, then you would just move right away, but the fact that she had a child was irresponsible, really.
Yeah, I mean, if I had Darren there as my little boy, I'd be like, nah, we'll just move back.
You wait a minute, let them come past, do what they need to do, and then you can go on your way.
Yeah, because you've seen Stallion like go and you had to physically stop him, like get his bearings to see where Ambrose went, because there's this pram that went out of nowhere.
Yeah. So I went outside, into the entrance ramp. There's a horrible. I didn't see the spot because it was like
in it's a far
you could
crowded.
Hear it.
Yeah.
You could definitely hear him hear Ambrose or one of them anyway getting smacked by barriers. So that was all good. There was a horrible spot towards the end.
Oh, after he got back in the ring,
I've seen Stallion do the spot a couple of times, stepping back, all stunned. He steps back, puts his foot between the middle of the bottom rope, and he leans back and falls out the ring. I've seen him do it loads of times, but God, as soon as I saw him do it, all you heard was as his head.
Sickening thwack on the. It wasn't even a padded floor, it was a pure wooden floor, it was nothing but wood. It was head to wood. And I was just like, I mean, we all know wrestling's scripted and it's all sort of done that way, but my God, the instant reaction from both of us was just like, oh my God, well, I won't say what I said, but you know, I was like, that's real. I was like, is he okay? Just like, sort of like, you could see he was quite clearly stunned. Then he took was almost like a curb stomp from Ian Ambrose, and I was just like, wow, he just did that, and then he took a curb stomp from Ambrose. Like, wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, but it was just the initial hit. It was like, you can't fake that. You can't fake land on the back of your head.
No, I'm sorry.
On a wooden floor, and jeez.
I mean, you can come at me all day long and wax lyrical about how wrestling's scripted, how they're trained to take bumps, X, Y, and Z. But I'm sorry, if you see that, if this match goes on YouTube or you see fan footage, cam footage anywhere, and you see that spot, and you tell me it's fake. I'm going to slap you, because that, simple as, was not fake.
You just can't. It's like, basically, try, say, if you fell off something and smacked the back of your head.
Yeah.
That's it. It's like, there's no way you could prepare for it.
That bit is worse, because Stallion's easily 6'2", and then by the time he falls out of the ring, and his head goes down the distance from being in the ring itself, it's just, oh, no. But I'll give them a due, they got up, they carried on, Stallion appeared fine, and he got on with it, and you couldn't tell, he'd smash his head off the ground legitimately.
Yeah, they just carried on, it was more just testament to Stallion. Right, we can't speak about this match without speaking about one very particular person.
Yeah.
We're going to try to do this...
No names we mentioned.
No, that's not the person yet. There's another person.
Wow. Yes.
We're going to try to remain objective. Because,
again, I will not see what's happening Saturday.
Because we're very much taken. But Debbie Sharp was there.
My God, she was there.
She was there. She was wearing a little black dress. And I think that's all we can say without being perverted. But she was there, and she led to the finish of the match.
Yep.
Stallion was trying to get her to go backstage. Dennis Stamp came out of the ring and was ushering away Debbie as well. As Stallion got back in, he was hit with a code breaker
with
the belt on Ambrose's knee, and that was good enough for the three count. So Debbie, she was already, you could tell she was turning heel at the start, before this anyway, but now she's officially turned.
Ditched Stallion and is in the camp of the current reigning defending SW champion, Mr. Scumbag Ian Ambrose.
Yeah. I don't think Debbie needed to be out as early as she was, because she did a lot of standing around. It played into the finish, but she could have came out later. I don't think she needed to come out right at the start.
No, I mean, the match was barely 2 minutes old and she was out straight away, so it was like, I mean, if she's going to be out that long, she may as well coming out with Stallion.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, I agree with that. But yeah, so she was out far too early, in my opinion. But
it's not a slight in the work. She did her job. She did the distractions in the spots
she
did, well.
She distracted more than just Stallion.
Yeah. And she had the belt in the ring repetitive times, you know, to sort of make the distractions and try and
get
Ambrose a win.
Yeah, I don't think she needed to be out so early, but I was quite glad that she was, because Debbie's lovely. Okay, now we're going to get onto the bit that you're so dying to talk about.
I'm going to say dying, I'm just sort of like eager to get it said, put it to bed, so to speak.
Aye, so we can move on.
Yeah.
There was a fan incident.
Well,
one particular person who I know who it is. A lot of people do know who it is, but I'm not going to name names because I don't want to give them the satisfaction of having their name everywhere.
The further publicity or spotlight that they don't deserve.
Oh, yeah. So before the Yuji Maki Braveheart match, all I saw was her knocking Ewan's hat off.
Yeah.
Apparently, she also punched Ewan as well.
Yeah, going by Ewan's Facebook update from last night, she punched Ewan and also knocked his hat off and knocking damaged his hat.
Yeah, which sounds silly when it comes to the hat thing, but that's his property.
End day one, that's Ewan's property. Two, we're paying to see them.
Mm.
Three, they're putting a show on for us. Four, you don't touch the wrestlers.
Then the worst one was as Debbie was ringside.
I won't say what I said on Saturday because it'll just rip the podcast, but you remember what I said.
The same person grabbed Debbie, I think it grabbed her hair.
Grabbed her by the hair, and I could be wrong on this, but I'm pretty sure she got her to the ground.
Yeah.
I think I'm wrong about that, but I think she took her to the ground.
I didn't hear about that at all. I just heard that. I heard he grabbed her, and again, it's not right anyway.
No,
it's not right either way. Regardless, it's assault. That's it.
Yeah.
Plain and simple. This person, I've met several times, and as I put in on the review on OSWtv, the WordPress site, she doesn't get the wrestling scripted.
No.
That's the basic and be all and end all.
There's nothing wrong with. Sometimes, like even now, ourselves, we can get drawn into the suspension of disbelief. But clearly, disbelief is constantly suspended, obviously, because, you know.
Because for me, when I go to wrestling, I believe it's real. Because if I don't, I'm not going to enjoy it. I go there to see a show, and I'm there, I'm sucked in. Because at the end of the Marty Jones match, I was urging him to punch Felix Fortune.
Yeah, you're on your feet. Punch him. Go on.
Go on, Marty. Punch him in the face.
Right in the face.
But I wouldn't ever go in and go, I'll punch you in the face.
Yeah, it's like me during the flag match. I was screaming for Viper. I was like, come on, Viper. And you're like, she's not gonna get it. I was like, come on, Viper. You can do it. You
special
know?
Disbelief is great. You have it. It's love perfect. It. But you don't touch. You don't touch the. You don't go to a theater show and see something you don't like and go, oh, I'm gonna fucking grab them. Damn it. We got 50 minutes before I swore.
Even I've not sworn. I'm proud of myself.
Oh no.
It's fine, this is why there's editor.
This isn't going on radio now, it's going on YouTube and staying there.
I wouldn't go to Elgin City and like lean over the wall, because obviously at League 2 in Scotland, lowest senior league of football, you can reach the players, but I wouldn't do that. Same with wrestling. Yeah. I wouldn't be in the front row where I've been many times and reach over the barrier and grab a wrestler.
You put your hand out to get high-fived. That's it.
Yep.
That's the only time you put your hand anywhere over the barrier.
Yeah, maybe a little a pat on the shoulder and say, oh, you're amazing or something like that. You know, yeah. Like you see all the time in other shows. But, nah. What happened should not have happened. I'm sure that the authorities at SWE will deal with her swiftly and severely as deserved. And that is all I have to say in the matter, because I have no interest in entertaining that crap anymore.
If you want to see my full opinion, you can go to OSWTV.wordpress.com and I have it at the bottom of the review. It's pretty much all I need to say about it and everything I have viewed on the subject, because it shouldn't happen. But I mean, it was no fault of SWE, because
no, not in the slightest.
They don't know that she's going to do that.
No one could have seen that. I have never seen that. Only time I've seen that would be the infamous CM Punk incident a couple of years ago.
Was that when someone tapped him in his back? He punched the wrong fan.
Yeah, CM Punk turned around and clocked a fan.
Did he even punch the right one?
Yeah,
punched the wrong one.
But it's beside the point, you know. I mean, obviously it's a little bit different because they're in the crowd, but. This was just bang out order. But like I said, that's me. I've said my piece, I'm done.
Anyway, overall, so that was our third SWE Hell for Lycra, so we really can now start comparing them a bit more. Because once you've seen two, then you'll look at one to compare it with.
Yeah.
Me personally, I enjoyed the majority of the show. It was all good. I don't think it was as good as last year, but that's just my personal. I thought last year's was a far stronger show. It had a far, far stronger story going into it as well, with the whole Braveheart Ted thing.
Yeah.
But overall, I mean, when it comes to Scottish wrestling shows, I've never been disappointed. I always like to find the positives.
The only disappointment I've had with any Scottish wrestling show so far would be the lack of Scottish wrestling shows up in Elgin and the North area. That's the only issue I've got.
So if you're listening to the SWE Hell for Lycra review, we're probably done now. We're going to speak about Scottish wrestling in general. So just to warn you. But keep listening. We're
Yeah, there's not much more to go, but there's some good stuff to come up.
Yeah.
Like in October.
Oh yeah, October. We'll speak about Discovery more in a sec, because I'll show my stuff first.
Right away.
Rock and Wrestle is becoming a brand in its own. It is now going to be a wrestling company. It set up two shows previously through PBW, and now they're going to be their own brand. In October, they've got the Highland Slam Tour, which is in Strathpeffer, and also in Forres in October, which is the 18th and 19th.
That sounds about
It's the Friday and Saturday, anyway.
Well, that'll be the 17th and 18th, then, because Discovery's the 11th.
Ah, okay, 17th and 18th, then. It helps when I know the own dates for the shows. It also helps because I'm going to be there, so yeah. I like to know when they
we
are.
We do.
So I'll be at both, but it's going to be. They've already got BT Gunn versus Chris Travis announced, which is going to be amazing. And they've also got guys like Jack Jester, Kid Fight already on the. That's someone texting.
I'm absolutely
me. Awesome.
Right. Buzzing for Jack Jester, like.
Jack Jester's awesome. I've seen him a few times for PBW for wrestles. Well, he's scary. I've met him. He's scary.
I seen him beat the hell out of Drew last night at ICW, and I was like, wow.
Oh, I've only seen the picture when with the fire. That's all I've seen.
Yeah.
So, very much, Drew will be the good guy, I'm guessing. I don't know. ICW kind of is foreign to me, because you can be as sadistic as that and come out as a good guy.
Yeah.
I would love to go to ICW, but it's
2015, we will make it. We said it last year, but next year we're going. I don't care, we're going.
I've already been like 10 shows this year, so yeah, I'm pushing it to attend ICW, even though they are in Dundee on the 11th, oh no, 10th of October.
Yeah.
But anyway, right, so Discovery, we'll speak about Discovery.
As you may or may not have heard a little bit earlier, we mentioned very, very, very briefly Alan Smith, aka Mr. News, my personal hero who I mark out for all the time. Is running his own promotion
with Alex Fowlis.
Alex Fowlis, former general manager of SWE.
I know, he beat me in that competition.
Damn location. Discovery Wrestling is starting in Edinburgh on the 11th of October, and after much not persuasion, but much anticipation and want for me to start doing something properly with OSWTV, but given that two circumstances that not able to get into as many events as Billy.
I have no life. that's basically what you're skirting around the subject. I have no life.
It's not even that. It's more like, you know, like my personal circumstances through work and things like that. And even still now through work, it's still difficult because I can't say, yeah, by the way, work, I'm going to go to this and then go home and say, yeah, by the way, hey, Nadia, and hey, Dan, I'm going away this weekend again. Bye.
Yeah, I say lucky. I live on my own. I do have I know it's weird. We're doing a podcast. We're both guys. We're both wrestling fans. But we both have girlfriends. I know, crazy.
Like I said to the guy who runs the Level of Wrestling podcast on Saturday when we met him in the queue, I was like, hey, just give me the meme, achievement unlocked, girlfriend and child, achievement unlocked, I've done it. I'm a wrestling fan with a girlfriend and a child, and they're real, they're not fake, they're not on Twitter or Facebook. Well, they are on Twitter and Facebook. Well, Facebook, Dan's not, but obviously. They're real.
Yeah. But,
they exist.
Yeah, we're weird off a little bit. Yeah, basically, I live on my own, so I can afford to just... say afford. That's probably not the word. I could just up and go. Yeah, that's probably the best way to do it. I could just up and go to events.
I could do that, but
I think you'll be in trouble.
Oh, I've been lots and lots of trouble. More than it's worth.
Oh, it's quick mention. Yeah, Levels Wrestling on Twitter. I don't always handle this, though. Is it just... Level of LOW or something like that.
Okay, he was tweeting last night and
for the last tweeted me, but record on my phone, so I could check, but
yeah.
Right, we'll get back to the minute. We met him and he was very nice.
Yeah.
I think that's where we're going. But yeah, where are we? Speaking about Discovery still, aren't we? That's 9th October.
Yeah, quite a lot of good matches on the card already. We have got Chris Sabin and Mike Mondo coming over. And alongside them, it's going to be Yo, it's crime time!
Yeah, Mike Mondo versus Joe Coffey.
Yeah, that's going to be great.
Wild Lions versus, is it Traditionalists, I think they're against? The six-man tag, which is Crime Time and Grado.
Yeah, and it's going to be absolutely amazing because I've met Guru previously. The boy's an absolute legend. I'm absolutely buzzing to meet Crime Time because I just love, like, sort of the terrible, not terrible gimmicks, but like comedy gimmicks like that.
Yeah, it shouldn't have worked, but Crime Time worked.
Yeah, definitely.
JTG, like, longest serving jobber. And
yeah,
although Zack Ryder's probably got him in the sweepstakes.
Well, he's now the longest serving one there, yeah, but definitely. But JTG, he picked up his phone that awful day, but you know, it's not an awful day because I get to meet him. Woo! Can't wait.
They'll
be going up against Joe Hendry, Global Hero, Billy's favourite.
My boy. Joe Hendry,
Global Hero, not local anymore. And two more unnamed opponents as of yet. There's also going to be the Y Division. We've certainly got a lot of talent there as well. Yeah. Viper's been slated to the Y Division.
Got Ian Ambrose.
Ian Ambrose is coming down. Stallion's coming down as well by the looks of things.
I've got Damian Daniels,
Damian Daniels,
in WrestleZone.
Yeah.
Who is very good. There's probably still names to announce.
There's much more to announce. Much more.
Damon O'Connor versus Rampage Brown is the other match.
That will be fantastic. That will just be an absolute slugfest.
Oh, yeah.
And that will be my first official assignment on my own.
Yep. I'm sending Kevin out. Because OSWtv, a lot of it is stuff I write, B, I record, or C, I share. Because I share a lot of stuff from guys like Break the Boss, Wrestle Ropes. But it's nice to have original content. That's what we need, original programming. So that's why I've got Kevin on board to do some stuff, writing and or videos or whatnot. Just to help out, basically. Yeah. Because I am one man. And even though we've just passed 7,000 views on the WordPress site,
woo!
I can tell you the exact number as of recording, as I'm scrolling. 7,079 views,
woo!
200 of which is on the Hell for Lycra review. So
it'll be more than that now, surely.
I think so. I would hit refresh, but this thing is like the slowest thing in the world. Yes, so yeah, original content, that's exactly what we need. Oh, it went up by 3.
Woo!
7,082.
Happy days.
Yeah, so that's what's happening. This is like a pilot kind of thing. I don't know if I'm sure we'll do more podcasts in the future, but
definitely we will, but it's just don't expect them to be regular. They'll be erratic because Obviously, I have a family and work full time. Billy works full time. Plus, he's got all the radio stuff.
Because I work full time. I turn up to work full time.
Yeah.
I don't work full time. but yeah, I've got loads of radio stuff as well. So we're just about to hit the hour, so I think it'd be a good time to finish up. So you've been listening to the first OSWtv podcast that is not a podcast because it's going on YouTube. Yeah. with myself, Billy, the big cheese of OSWtv, you can contact us many ways. At Voice of OSW, you can plug your own Twitter in a moment. At Voice of OSW, facebook.com/OSWTV. You'll get to see me a lot, either at shows or on the Alternative Wrestling magazine and Across the Pond Wrestling. I thought you were checking your phone for how long I was going for.
No.
All my accolades. You'll hear me on Wave Radio as well, which is waveradio.org.uk on Mondays from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. 8 o'clock onwards is the wrestling half hour. Monster FM in September I will be on constantly for wrestling wise, because you're not interested in the music, but wrestling wise I'm on from Sundays directly opposite Wrestle Talk TV and British Wrestling Roundup, because it sucks. which I'll be on speaking about Scottish professional wrestling, with the first show being that interview I had half it anyway with Alan Smith. I'll probably chip in towards the end, but Kevin, you can say your goodbyes now.
Thanks for listening. If you're listening, if you're not listening, please listen. I've been Kevin Morrison at Markout Morrison on Twitter. I'm a giant big mark and will mark out for anything and everything. Follow everything Billy said, read the site, read the reviews, everything. Send us tweets, listen to the podcast, plug us anywhere.
Just support wrestling.
Yeah, Scottish wrestling. WWE's good, but my God, Scottish wrestling's better. I don't know what anyone says.
Because I've already sworn in this, I'm going to do my usual send-off for videos. If you have been listening, great. If you haven't, go fuck yourself. Good night, folks.